All right, so just a second. Those are my notes. Don't look at that. Okay, we're already a little slow to start, but let's get going. Thanks for being here. It's great to see a full room. Let's get started. So my name is Robin Barry. I work at Palantir, and I'm a senior engineer and team lead. And Larry, why don't you introduce yourself?
I'm Larry Garfield, senior architect at Palantir, and Drupal 8 web services initiative lead. So Robin and I work together on projects, lots of them.
It's true. We're best buddies now. Okay, so here's our lab format. We're going to do short lectures and then hands-on exercises. And we're recommending, especially with this full room, that people pair up. So that way you can help your neighbor. Larry and I will try and walk around the room and answer questions, but with this many people, try to help yourselves as best you can.
And each other.
Yes, well, that's what I meant. Help each other. That's right. It's all about community, right? So let's move forward with that. So there are a couple of things that we're assuming you have a basic understanding of, and if you don't, you'll still survive this lab, but you should look them up. And one is PHP 5 introduces namespaces and interfaces, which is something you'll just want to know about for object-oriented programming. And there's also PSR 0, which is about to turn into PSR 4. Which controls the directory structures we'll see in the modules.
And we'll flag for you where that's going to change. The core team was trying to get that fixed in time for this week, but didn't quite make it, so that'll probably change next week. It's easy, though. Don't worry.
That's right. And if you want to learn more, you go to github.com/php-fig.
Or php-fig.org.
Great. Okay, our goals. That you will learn how to create routes and controllers for requests, that you'll be able to define common module plugins, that you can store default module settings and configuration, that you know how to create pages, blocks, and have an understanding of state, and hopefully we inspire you to learn more about Drupal 8. The subjects we'll be covering today include the HttpKernel, routing, and controllers, basics of theming for module developers, dependency injection, forms and configuration, plugins, including annotations. And now to your setup. So our goal is that you already have Drupal 8 installed on your machine. Did everyone bring their stuffed animal? This was in the lab description. Your stuffed animal.
Here we go.
Okay. So. The stuffed animal will become relevant when I describe the Drupal Gachi module, which is what we're going to be working with today. So so get your stuffed animal ready, or imagine that you have one. And what we would want to do is install the Drupal Gachi module in Sites All modules.
Actually, it's in / modules. In Drupal 8.
You're right. Oh my God, my mistake.
Many things have changed in Drupal 8, including the slide. So where it says Sites All modules, just do / modules. We'll explain the directory structure in a little bit.
Great. Thanks, Larry. Old habits. and so when you, with the Drupal Gachi module, if you do have access to their net, make sure you check out the branch labeled lab-01-initial. So that's our starting point. And we're going to go from branch to branch to see the completed code as we go through each exercise. So a little bit about our Drupal Gachi module. I don't know, does anybody remember Tamagotchi? They're little handheld devices. All right, I got a couple hands up there. So it was like this little digital device that came out in the 90s. And basically, you had to care for this little device and to help them learn about Earth. Right, they're alien species. So we've created a module that basically has the same needs. You're going to name, and basically what it does, it turns your website into a little Tamagotchi of sorts. So your website will have a name, and it has a certain amount of happiness it would like to have, and it achieves that by having the admin user, right, UID equals one, visiting the site repeatedly. So when other people visit, it's not as excited. But when you go to your website, it's a happy Drupal gotchi. So now I'm going to switch over to Larry, and we'll get into some of the details about D8.
Okay. So one of the important changes with Drupal 8 is that it's now built more around the way the web itself is designed to work. So most PHP 4 applications, including Drupal itself, were built on this model. Can people see this, the slides? Okay. Can't really make it larger here, but.
Can we turn these lights off up there?
I don't have no idea how.
No.
I don't know if I can zoom it. Sort of. Okay. So, yeah, you have got, when the PHP process starts, that's a bit better. PHP process starts, you have a bunch of super globals that are created by the system for you. And stuff happens that is whatever your program is, and you generate output by a mixture of calling header to set HTTP headers, or in most cases, just printing stuff at random places. And you hope you get that in the right order, and you hope that you print strings that line up properly, and it involves a lot of hope. And I am all for hope, but not as a basis of software architecture. This is how HTTP actually works, Hypertext Transfer Protocol. Conceptually, a request comes in. A request is a concept unto itself. It's a message. And then your server does whatever black magic it's going to do and returns a response. Not a string, it returns a response. A response is, again, a message. It's an encapsulated message of some kind that includes more than just a blob of string, a blob of text. This model is closer to HTTP kernel. This is one of the most important parts of the Symfony framework. This is the part that we pulled in first, and this is what really kicked off the major changes in Drupal 8, that the entire architecture is modeled on this idea of a request comes in, response goes out, and there's just a process by which you convert a request to a response. Everything in Drupal now is a request comes in, response goes out, and stuff happens in the middle. But everything comes down to that model. And it's a really very simple interface. This is the entirety of the HTTP kernel interface that is the basis of any Symfony using project, which is about 24 projects now, including Drupal. Very simply, you have a handle method, request comes in, and response goes out. You will almost never see this yourself, yeah. It's kind of dark.
It's blurry.
Is that any better? Okay. Oops. Oops.
Whoa.
I think that's about as good as it's going to get. Okay. So, this is a very intimate session. That's why we're turning down the lights. Anyway. You as a module developer will almost never deal with this interface directly, unless you're doing some really advanced, wacky stuff. But I'm showing this to emphasize that this is the model around which the system is built. It's no longer built on a super globals come in, build up a bunch of PHP stuff, print stuff, and hope it all works out model. It's built on exactly this. This request object encapsulates all of the incoming HTTP information, the body, the path, the accept headers, the language headers, the HTTP method, and all those other things that have always been there, but have been really hard and annoying for us to get at. And that request is where you'll pull all that information from. And then the entire purpose of the Drupal process, of the HTTP kernel process, is generate a response, which is, again, some kind of body, maybe, plus headers. And those headers could include things like language, content type, you know, HTTP 200 error or 404 or 418 or various other things. There's a lot more here that you can do very easily. Be specific, and you probably can't see that. You can't actually zoom with the slideshow tool I discovered. So you can't really zoom it in.
In the browser?
That's what I tried to do. I think. Hang on. Stand by. Let's see if I can get this bigger. Does that help at all? That's kind of weird. Yeah, it's zooming in on the center. Oh, hang on. Reveal JS, yes. Yeah.
You could do this.
What's that?
Option click.
Okay, can you unzoom what you're doing? Trying to zoom
bigger.
So people in the back can see.
Let's stop doing that.
All right, undo.
Different.
Undo.
All right. I'll see what we can do with that.
I may be turned off.
Let's just try the option click.
I make a mirror.
Hang on. Mm-hmm. No, we don't want to mirror it.
No?
No. We've got slide notes here. Okay.
Deal with it.
No. Can you undo whatever it was you just did?
Yeah, just go back to the regular.
Yeah.
Go back.
I think the notes window here is now weird.
Okay, I'll fix it.
So, option click, you said?
Yes. Control click?
Control click. No?
Really?
Ooh, okay, there we go.
That's okay. Same thing. Isn't that what you used to
do? On the wrong window. I'm not sure if this is Reveal doing it or on the Mac. All right. Moving right along. So specifically, we're using the HTTP kernel implementation provided by Symfony itself. So the actual pipeline here is identical to someone using Symfony Full Stack or Silex or a number of other projects. Request comes in, and then an event fires called a request event. Events, simplest explanation, object-oriented hooks. It's basically what they are. And the request event you can think of as kind of like a hook request alter. There's various things you can do there. The main one, though, is enhancing the request and gathering information from the system based on that request. And that includes the routing process to decide, all right, what's going to handle this request? And that determines something called a controller. A controller is the more generic name for what we've traditionally called a page callback. So what we used to call page callbacks, they're now called controllers. Close enough. And so there's an event there. You'll pretty much never use the controller event yourself, I expect, but it's there. And then that controller gets called. The controller can be any PHP callable. So with hook menu, the page callback had to be a function. With the new model in Drupal 8, it technically can be a function, a method of an object, a static method of a class, an anonymous function, or various other things. In practice, it will 99.4% of the time be a method on an object. And that's what where you're going to be putting your controller code. That controller, it's just any PHP callable, can return a number of things. It can return a response. Let's see if I can scroll over here. Whoa.
Wow.
Yeah, all right. All right. The controller can return any number of things, one of which can be an HTTP response object. If it is, great. We just send that along. And then your controller is responsible for the entirety of the response to that request. You can bypass the entire theme system, the entire lock wrapping, whatever, just return a response object, and you have complete control over what gets sent back. It's very useful if you want to have custom one-off pages, wrapping some other system, perhaps, of various other things. If it's not a response, which in actually most cases won't be, then there's another event called a view event, nothing to do with the views module, that can take whatever that is and turn it into a response object. Most cases, again, you won't have to deal with this directly. It's there to take whatever it is you return, usually a render array or a string, and turn that into a page. Then there's a response event that happens in either case. Again, essentially hook response alter is conceptually what it is. And that's where you can set extra HTTP headers if you want to. That's where we're going to be doing caching, cache control in Drupal 8 because we're using HTTP to control our caching now. And then that response gets sent. And then there's a terminate event, which is essentially hook exit. Important things to note here. Unless your controller actually invokes hooks, you can get through this entire pipeline without ever touching a hook. Everything can be purely objects and methods and events, no hooks, no procedural code at all. And that's a good thing, because that makes it way more testable. So let's talk about these controllers. So controllers, formerly PHP or page callbacks. This is the simplest possible controller. So you have a method. Your controller, that method gets called by the routing system. And you return a response that is the entire response from HTML tag to HTML tag. And that's what gets sent back. You have now bypassed all of Drupal. And you're just going to return the entire page. You have that level of control if you want it. In most cases, you don't actually want that, unless you're doing AJAX. In most cases, you can also put multiple methods in the same class. And this is good for code organization. So they could be in the same class or separate classes. It's up to you to decide what organization makes sense for your module. I think most core modules right now just have one class and a bunch of short methods. That may break out a bit more, but that level of flexibility is something you can change as needed. And you can return not just an HTML response. You can also return JSON responses. So in this case, we have a blob of JSON data. We'll just pass it in. Instead of doing print Drupal to JSON exit, no. That's a first class supported concept now. So you just return this JSON response object, which is a subclass of response, and it takes care of all the HTTP headers for you. So this will get sent back with the correct headers, correct encoding, all that kind of stuff. You can also just return a string. If you return a string, we'll take that and wrap it up into a page for you. So again, this is the same as in Drupal 7. If you return a string from a page callback, that string is the body of the page. And then it gets wrapped up with blocks and header and all that kind of fun stuff. Pretty much the same thing here. And the more common case, render arrays are sadly still with us. So in this case, we say, return an array that's pound theme, which is the name of the key of some Drupal themeable chunk, defined by hook theme, which is still there, just hasn't really changed, and whatever variables go into that. So that's your common cases. The fun part is when you get to more esoterics. So for example, let's say you're returning a CSV file of some kind. So you're pulling data out of a database table. You want to return that as a CSV. Great, wonderful. Traditionally, you would do that by building up a gigantic string yourself and returning it, and possibly blowing out your memory, or by iterating and printing stuff on the fly, and then calling exit early and bypassing half of Drupal that Drupal was not designed to be bypassed, which sucked. Instead, what you can now do is use this thing called stream response. And so you can set its header specifically. So I'm setting back text CSV. And then instead of setting a string as the body, we just pass in a callable, in this case an anonymous function. And then later on, once we get past that response event and we're actually sending the response, then this will get called and one by one spool out each line. All of that's taken care of for you. You don't have to think about what's my memory usage going to be. How do I avoid blowing out my memory? Do I need to exit early? You don't. That you just don't think about that because you have clear APIs for handling all of that kind of stuff. good common case of that, if you're reading a file off disk, in Drupal 7, there was a function you called that manually spooled the file off disk in chunks of 1 kilobyte to try to avoid blowing up memory, which is actually the slowest possible way to do it in PHP. In Drupal 8 and in Symfony, we built, built and committed upstream to Symfony, this binary file response. So you just give it the name of a file, and you're done. And you return that response. And that file will then get streamed off disk to the browser with all the correct headers, all the correct length encoding, all of that handled for you. You don't even have to think about it. In fact, if you know you're running on Nginx or Apache with the right installed options, there's an even faster way to do it using the xsend file header, for which there's native support, again, written by Drupalers for Symfony. So just stick this into your settings PHP on your production site. And when you're serving files out, they will be as fast as humanly possible. It's straight off the metal. You can also set your status code. So you can take the response object itself, set an alternate status code. Anyone know what HTTP 204 is? No one? 204, no content, which simply means we're going to send back a response. There is no body. There's headers, but no body. What's a good use case for that? Cron. This is what cron does right now, is do whatever it's going to do for cron and send back a message saying, OK, done. And then you can do anything that HTTP can do, you can do, which includes we do support HTTP 418. I'm a teapot. This is an actual defined part of the HTTP spec. And people say engineers don't have a sense of humor. You can also do parameters. So in Drupal 7, if you wanted to have parameters out of the path, then you would put a percent sign into your hook menu, and then it would match up based on the order of those parameters. Order doesn't matter anymore. Instead, you simply specify to and from. These are variables that are in your route definition. And you can also get the request itself. If we don't ask for the request, we don't get the request. We don't need it. If we actually need it, we can grab it. And then you do whatever we're going to do, put into a render array, do some processing on it, whatever makes sense. The route definition for that is now in a YAML file. So hook menu, at the moment still exists, is going to stop existing very soon. Hook menu in Drupal 7 was doing about 8 different things that had no business being in the same system and caused all kinds of problems. For Drupal 8, we've pulled it apart. So the parts that actually relate to routing are now handled through a routing.yaml file, which means it's very easy to edit. You don't even have to be a PHP developer to do so. And then the other pieces we're not going to talk about as much today, broken out to other systems and other files. But for the moment, so we've got this route, which we're defining by its machine name, not keyed by path, because a route could match on path or on mime type or on method, various other things. So you can actually now have multiple routes at the same path that are handled by different controllers. And that's how we're doing REST in Drupal 8. And we can specify placeholders with brackets, so from and to here. But notice, here we say from to, here we say to from. That doesn't matter. It matches by name, not by your position. So you can put them in whatever order you want. It's not going to break. And that's handled magically on the fly. And we specify underscore content is this method of this class, which means this is going to be a normal page, the contents of which are this is the controller for, that hello world method of this class. So this replaces the page callback key, essentially. For as a requirement, it has to have the user has to have the permission to access content. And one nice feature here, access callback is not a single value anymore. You can stack multiple access control options on the same route. So if you want to say, you have to have this permission or this other permission, you can do that. You want to say the user must be, must match this complex situation, so a custom checker there, or have this override permission, like access all views or something like that, you can do that. You don't need to do a completely custom wrapper for that. A lot more we could say about that. And you can also restrict those placeholders by regular expression. So if you want to say this has to be an integer, you can restrict it to that. In this case, we're saying they both have to be strings. So if you go to /hello/world/1/2, this won't match because you don't want to deal with numbers, you want to deal with strings. And with that, let's get your hands dirty. So this is the, hopefully we can see that, github.com/palantirnet/DrupalGotchi, or the USB key that's working its way around the room, I hope. And then check out this branch. And we want you to write these controllers. We want a string that returns hello world as a Drupal page, and a JSON string that says hello world. Let's just start there. There should be a skeleton you can just start filling in. Let's give it a try. Who has the module already copied down?
Oh, hey.
Nice, okay. Did the internet come back? Or are we just really good with SneakerNet?
Yeah.
Okay, you did get it checked out? Good. So yeah, check it out. Grab this branch. Turn the module on and start filling stuff in based on what we were just talking about. Where do you put it? Yes. I thought we had this slide. Did it get taken out?
I think it got taken out.
Okay. We took that slide out at the last second. So the structure of Drupal 8 has changed, the file structure. You'll notice a directory called /core. Don't touch anything in there. Everything that used to be at the top level is now down in there, and that's the stuff that you pretty much never touch. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. So at the top level. Oh, we have NetBeans. Okay. Okay.
So.
Right. So we've got this core directory, and that's where core modules go, the core libraries, all this kind of stuff. Pretty much you are not going to edit files in there as a module developer. There's now a top level modules directory. That is for your modules. And the question over here, you can still do the contrib and custom directories under there. That logic still works. But this replaces sites all, essentially. There's also a theme directory. Where's that? Yeah, themes. And again, this is for your custom themes for your site. The sites directory is still there. Sites default settings works the same way it always has. So that part's still the same, but essentially sites all has moved up a couple levels. Inside the module, you'll find a couple of directories. We're going to talk about some of these later. Your info file is now also in YAML. Who here has worked with YAML, the file format, before? Okay, then this should all be very familiar. So how do I make this bigger? There we go. So the keys are pretty much the same as they were in Drupal 7. They're just done in YAML now. Name, you do have to specify type of module. This should all be in the module you downloaded, description, and core compatibility version. Still the .module file. Pretty much nothing's going to go in there except hooks in practice. The routing file, routing.yaml. I think the module should have a sample of that already.
It does. Actually, you have the master branch checked out there.
Oh,
so do you want me to switch you over to the initial?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Okay, if you look at the master branch, that has everything we're doing today completed, so don't start there. There will be a test later. Don't skip ahead.
That's recursive, but it should be better. So we should be able to get in there.
Okay.
Routing.
we've got one sample route already defined here. Path is, which button is it?
So it was the wrong route.
You probably were checked out to master, yeah.
Oh.
So everyone check out the correct branch, the O1 branch. The USB key that's being passed around is a full repository, so you can just do a local checkout of the other branch. If you do git branch, it'll list them. You want the O1 branch. It's a lab O1 initial. Okay. So it's same as we saw before. Here's the path. It begins with a leading slash. DrupalGotchi bracket person, which means there's a person placeholder. The defaults content, and that's, you know, class name and a method. And in this case, we have the access content permission. You mentioned before about PSR0 versus PSR4. All those mean are organization for classes. So you've got lib, Drupal, DrupalGotchi, and various directories. This is where all of your classes live in your class. And their names, if we look at them, match up with, match up with their namespace. So this class is in the Drupal, DrupalGotchi controller namespace. And so it's in the module directory lib, Drupal, DrupalGotchi controller. The only difference that's going to happen in about a week is this extra Drupal and DrupalGotchi directories here are going to go away. Everything's just going to move up two levels. That's the only change there. So as we were trying to get that done before this week, it didn't quite make it, so expect that next week.
Larry, does that change the namespace you would use too?
It does not change the namespace. It just changes the organization of files. Basically, PSR0 is a namespacing and autoload standard that mandates this, that your namespace and your class's namespace and your files on disk map one-to-one. PSR4 is exactly the same thing, except you get a prefix. So when we configure the autoloader, we skip over some directories that you don't want to have to repeat for every single module. So actually, the support for PSR4 in Composer is being written by Drupal developers. We're going to be the first project using PSR4. The class should already be there for you. And then you're just going to fill in these methods. So really all you should need to do is fill in here and here, and then in the routing file. And 1:39 now, so.
Oh, there's a
question.
I think that means there's a chair available.
The goal is to fill in these two controllers. The first one just returns the string hello world, and the second one returns a JSON message that says hello world. Okay? And you're going to need to fill in the controller and your routing information in the routing YAML file. So please do work with people next to you. It's kind of hard to walk around. If you have questions, raise your hand. We'll try and come around to you. I think we're going to take like 15, 20 minutes for this.
Yeah, probably less since we started a little late. So, well, let's see what people do.
So just a note, it looks like a couple of people are running Drupal 8 Alpha 3. That's not going to work. There have been some subtle API changes. You do want to be running a checkout that's like 2 days old at most. So be running a very up-to-date version of Drupal 8 head at the moment. Robin.
Get that posted.
If you want to grab a copy of the slides, they're on GitHub. github.com/palanternet/slides-d8-lab.
Maybe.
What? The code is Drupal, the Drupal Gachi module, which is also on.
Was there a copy of Core on the key?
Yeah, I don't know who put that on there.
We didn't.
Yeah, because it was.
Yeah, some people are saying it's Alpha 3, which is unfortunately not going to work.
Yeah.
What's that? No, that. It needs to be a version that's no more like 2 or 3 days old.
Sure.
Ooh. Even we can't get out, and I'm on the wire. So if you can't see this URL right now, we will post it on our session page on the Prague DrupalCon site. So you will have access to the slides and the code. --branch 8.x if you're doing the git clone. The branch is lab-01-initial. The old branches were still in there. I didn't have time to delete them. They are, the slides I'm using right now are on my laptop, but it looks like the GitHub repository for the slides is not public right now, so we'll make sure that you guys have the slides. I apologize for any confusion about that. But the slides will definitely be on the DrupalCon Prague website, I promise. Maybe I can get them out there right now. Let me try that. You know what? For now. I'm not going to be able to make it public easily. Because I tried to do that the other day, and we're actually working off a, it forked from a private repo, and then you can't do what you want. So I know people wanted some hints, so I'm going to go back, Larry, so they can see some code from the earlier slides. Okay, here's the routing.yaml file. Do people want to see that? Are you more interested in the controller code? Say controller if you want controller code. I heard a controller. Oh, there's one. Let's go. There's the coffee. Do we have Jason? That's one I wouldn't mind showing folks. There it is. Okay. Here it goes. All right, so here are the two methods, hello and hello, Jason. Jason. So take a look at that. I'll see if I can make it bigger. Yeah? Can people see that a little bit? Or maybe come up front if you need to see some code. And then I also want to check in just to see how folks are doing. We have some other subjects we can cover, so it's a little bit up to you if you want to learn some more about dependency injection. Larry, go ahead.
Why don't we skip ahead and show the solution for this part, and
okay,
we can move on to the next section.
You need to type in the path for it because we didn't set up a menu item. So Larry's coming up. Do you want to talk about that?
Well, we are, but just...
Actually, isn't theming next? Weren't you going to have control if it does a theme?
Oh, yeah. Jake?
Do you want to just talk about that instead of having them do it?
Yeah, that's
now, next step, I think a lot of people managed to get through this one. So next thing we have not talked about yet is templates. We were just returning strings. Templates, as you probably have heard by now in Drupal 8, are now all twig. And by being twig, that means a couple of things. One, it means the syntax has changed for the template. Two, it means you can put a lot more display logic into the template than ever before in a sane fashion. So they're more secure, a lot more powerful, and there's a lot fewer divs, but that's not actually something we're talking about right here. So this is what a twig template file could look like. Note here a couple of important things. All of the markup is here, as is the string. So in Drupal 7, what we would probably do if we wanted to just take, you know, parameter out of the URL and say hello to that person, we would use the T function in the page callback to format that string, and then pass that string on to a theme function, which would just put P tags around it, and we're done. You can push that logic off to the template now. So instead, we say, see if we can get this bigger. Remember which button it is.
Control.
There we go. So what we pass through to Twig in this case is two variables, one named person, one named name. In Twig syntax, you place a variable with curly brace, double curly brace. And that's the equivalent of print variable name. We can also use this trans, so curly brace percent sign is some kind of directive. So you can do conditionals, for each loops, while loops, various other things in the Twig template itself in a secure fashion, including translation. So in this case, we can push the entire string off to the template layer, because that's part of the display. And we wrap it in trans and ntrans, and that string will get safely translated. That string will be available to translators. That string will properly escape person and name, just like a T function will. And you as a module developer can now give far, far more power to your themers, to your front-end developers, which means you don't have to worry about it, and they don't have to bug you to change something. If they want to change that string, they don't have to talk to you, they don't have to deal with a PHP module, they can just do that in a template. And that is awesome. All the themers I've talked to have just loved this idea. The question is, can we pass it on to check plane? Very good question. That's actually the second half of the slide. If I can scroll back out here. So outside of trans, you can actually control how a variable gets escaped in the template. So in this case, we're saying, you know, foo, whatever this variable is, pipe escape HTML. This means take this variable, escape it for HTML, and then print it. You can also escape it for JSON, for XML, for a couple of other things. And that's now controlled in the template. The default handling around the escaping is still, we're trying to let Twig take care of all of it and get rid of all of our own escaping. That's not entirely done yet, but this is, for the moment, how you would do that escaping yourself if you wanted to, say, you know, completely build your own A tag or something. Yes? So the question is, are these Drupal's tags or Symfony's tags? These are mostly Twig's tags. So most tags that you find just in the Twig documentation will work. Trans is a Twig thing, not a Drupal thing, not a Symfony thing. That's built in Twig. So this template here would work without modification on Symfony, on Silex, on anything else that uses the Twig template system. It's not Drupal specific. You can do Drupal-specific additions, and I think we have some, but most of it we're trying to keep as non-Drupal-specific as possible. So most of the templates are going to be reasonably portable to anything that uses Twig in concept.
Can I just add, there are Twig sessions over the next several days, so definitely attend them if you're interested in learning more about Twig and templates.
Yes. All right, so do you want to take time on this one, since we started late, or just walk past it?
Let's walk through it.
Okay. So next one, same idea, but this in this case we say hello to some parameter that comes from the URL. And let's actually just walk through this one directly.
Yeah, you want to check out.
I want to check out first.
You know how to check out code, right?
Yes, but I'm not sure which window I'm on.
Switch to that branch if you can get online. Or have
okay.
Module.
So first, a number of people notice this. We need to put a use statement at the top of the file so we have access to the JSON response object. And then for our just basic hello page, we can just return hello world. For the JSON version, we just return a JSON response object with that array. For the template version, we do this. We just return an array. This is a very small render array. There we go. Specifies our theme key and the value we're going to pass in. That matches up with a hook theme. Hook theme has not really changed at all from Drupal 7. Oops. In the wrong direction. So we just specify theme key, the template file it's going to use, and the variables that it's going to use. And then the template lives in a templates directory. And it's that one, I think?
Yeah.
Yep. And
that's exactly the file we saw on the screen a moment ago.
Come on.
There we go. And so just pass those values through, you can print them. That's actually for later functionality we haven't gotten to yet. Here's a trans. If your themer wanted to change these p tags to divs or section or aside or whatever, all of that's in here. If you want to change what the actual string is going to be, so it's not, you know, hello person my name is, but you want to, you know, structure it differently, like say yo instead of hello or whatever, then you do that in the template. The themer doesn't have to bug you anymore, and you don't have to do weird things to the translation system either. Questions on that? Yes. The question is it secure to just pass person on directly? Yes, it is, because anything in trans gets escaped just as if you were using a placeholder in T. This actually compiles down to something that is, I think it actually is the T function in practice. So inside the T here is secure. If you're not inside this trans block, then just pipe escape HTML in the template. So a lot of that escaping now moves a layer out to the template. You should not be doing that escaping in your controller. All right, let's talk more about routing. So we all just did some routing. Routing is simply the process of mapping from an incoming request to what controller is going to take care of it. And I'm going to walk through this as an example of the architecture in Drupal 8. This will not be on the test. Okay. The idea here is not to understand every class I'm going to talk about, just to understand the flow and the architectural concepts. So as we said, it's pretty much all based around listeners. So there's the kernel request event that fires. And one of the various things that happens there is matching. Matching is the process of taking, and you probably can't read this at all. Different keys does the zoom depending on whether I'm in the browser or in NetBeans. Thank you, Mac. So we're using a system called Dynamic Router, which is was a collaboration between Drupal and Symfony CMF. So the request comes in, and we call match on it, which is given this request, find me the find metadata from it. And we then go through a couple of steps. Route provider does an initial match, basically the same path-based lookup that we used in Drupal 7. The logic is almost identical in terms of how that works. But remember we said you can have multiple routes on the same path now. So just matching on path is not enough. So instead, this pulls back all routes that match just on that path, which is probably not going to be more than 3 or 4 ever, but conceptually could be some number, some larger number. So we get back something called a route collection, which is a glorified array of route objects. An entry in hook menu in the past roughly corresponds to a route. It's just represented as an object now. Then we can filter it with a series of filter passes, and that says, all right, I'm going to filter out routes based on the request only, the request is coming for text HTML. This route only matches on JSON, so I'm just going to ignore it. I'm going to throw that out. And your modules can add more filters if they want to. In practice, you probably won't need to do that very often. But something like, say, panels or page manager could use that to change routing based on, for example, the node type. Core is not doing that. And then we do a final match that matches on everything. Path, mime type, method, all the regex requirements. This is pulled straight out of Symfony. That will get back an array of attributes. Those attributes include the name of the controller to use. Then there's something called a route enhancer, a route enhancer, basically think of it as an alter hook, but done with objects. And what that lets you do is take that information and build up new information. What we're doing there, the actual routing happens on a key called underscore controller. In most cases, you're just going to specify underscore content. Underscore content means figure out the controller based on the MIME type. Why are we doing that? Because, do I still have a slide on this? I think so. We can say, this actually is one of the route enhancers we have in core. If there's no controller specified, but there is a content specified, figure out what the controller is based on the MIME type. Which means every page callback you write, every controller you write, can be used as its own page, or can be requested as an AJAX request, or can be used as a pop-up, all based on the MIME type coming in the request. And so like the overlay or the dialogue we have now in Drupal 8, we have a built-in modal mechanism. Any page can show up in that modal simply by telling the JavaScript to send the right MIME type. That's where a lot of this power comes from, so we can reuse a lot of the same code a lot better. Follow that pattern, and your code will just magically work in AJAX. Someone says yoo-hoo, I agree. Another step in here, access control. We talked about this a little bit. Who's ever heard of the distinction between authentication and authorization? People familiar with that concept? About half of you? Okay. So basic idea, authentication is who are you? It's just identifying, is this Larry, is this Robin, is this Bob, is this, you know, some terrorist? You just figure out who the person is. Authorization is, okay, now that we know who this is, are we going to let them do what they're trying to do? We can confirm this is Larry, but we're not going to let Larry do that. We can confirm this is Robin, we're going to let Robin do that, because Robin has more power than Larry does on the site. Just on that site.
Oh.
And this is, again, handled through these listeners. You will pretty much never deal with authentication yourself, aside from the fact that do not touch global user. That global is now gone. Actually, it technically still exists just to support the installer, but otherwise you should never, ever, ever touch it yourself. It was a security hole in the first place. Instead, we now have a service called current user. If you have an object or a class that cares about the current user, you request it explicitly. There is no global anymore. The access control part, as I said, we now allow multiple checks per route. We couldn't come up with a better name than a checker, so we're full of checkers now. Sorry to all the chess fans in the room. And an access checker can say, given this route, I'm actually going to care about it or not. And if it cares, then when a request comes in and it matches the route, we can say, all right, this checker is going to allow, deny, or kill. Allow, deny, or kill, what's killing? So with access callbacks, they could simply return a true or false, allow or not. When we have multiple, it gets a bit more interesting. So instead, you can stack them. And then you can stack them and say, for this route, all of them need to pass, or any one of them can pass. If you say any one of them can pass, then at least one needs to allow, and we don't care if any deny, but at least one needs to allow. If we require all, they all have to return allow, and none can return deny. Or, doesn't matter what your setting is, act all versus any, if you return kill, access is denied. Why would we bother doing that? Because let's say you're organic groups, and you want to add on to every route that's dealing with an entity, and potentially deny access based on group membership. You don't care if it's any or all, you're just going to allow unless the user doesn't have access for that group, and then you just terminate entirely. You can override it that way. In most cases, your access checks are just going to allow or deny. So here's an example. Let's see if I can zoom in a bit further. Yeah. So this is from the comment module. So we have comments, edit.edit page. This is the editing a comment page. And the access mode is any. So in order to have access to edit this comment, you can either have the edit any comment permission, or you can have the comment update access from the entity access system. And there's a bunch of other options here. You can write custom rules as well. Most of the time, you'll just be using permission, just like in the past. But this way, we don't need to write a new custom access check for every possible case. We can stack them and say, you know, this is a built-in part of Drupal. This is a built-in part of Drupal. We'll allow you to have either one of those, and then you're good to go. The actual permission checker, an example here. So it accesses the current user service, so it does have access to the current user. This is not exactly what's in core right now. I've tweaked it a little to fit on a slide. And then we have the applies to method, which should have a route parameter to it. I apologize for that. And it checks, all right, is there an underscore permission key in that route definition under requirements? If so, it's going to want to get called for this route. If not, don't even bother calling it. This allows us to have 47 access checkers in Drupal and only one or two run on each route. That's very good for performance. Then assuming it does apply, then on actual routing when we come in, so all right, let's get that permission string, and then does this current user have the permission, whatever that permission is. So here we said the edit any comment permission. So does the current user have the edit any comment permission? If so, return allow. If not, return deny. And we're never going to block it entirely. So does this completely block someone from accessing this route? That's not this object's job to check. It doesn't care. It just says, I'm going to allow or I'm not going to allow. I'm going to allow or deny. Questions on this part? Everyone completely confused? So yes, it is done on route build. So there's still a route build process, just like there was a menu rebuild process in the past. And that's when applies to gets called. So all 47 access checkers will have applies to called on every one of the routes, which are a couple hundred, maybe 1,000. But that only happens on build. That information is then stored on the route. So when we load the route after it's been matched, it has a list on it of these are the three access checkers to use. And then just those three we call the access method on. So those are called the two very different times. And that gets us very good performance, despite the fact that we now have a lot more flexibility in the access system than we've ever had before. I know multiple access callbacks was a request that's going back years. We now have it.
Yay.
Yes. So the question for the recording is basically, can you combine ands and ors? Say if a module comes along and adds another checker, no. We tried to figure out how to do more complex nested Boolean logic for that, and couldn't come up with a way to encode that wasn't evil. So in that case, you probably would need to remove the access checkers and write a custom one that wraps it. We have found actually in core, at least, which is now a rather big system, almost everything fits into just and or, or any and all. Nested cases are actually quite rare. And so those for that edge case, we're OK with just having a custom access checker in that case to handle it. Other questions before we move on? All right. Oh, is that someone coming up to the mic? Hooray, microphone.
Just as a summary, can you, now that we see seen the details, as a summary, can you go back to the overview slide of these and go through that once more, please?
Sure.
You can recall it.
This one?
Yes.
Okay. So just a quick recap here. So nested matcher, so a route object comes in here, past nested matcher, route provider returns, a request object comes through here, goes to route provider. Route provider gets a list of routes that match just on path. So it goes from the 500 routes in the system to 3 very quickly. Then you can filter that and say, all right, map, really the only filter we have at this point is MIME type, or the accept header. Get back a smaller route collection, do a full match, get back a list of attributes. That attribute list is everything that's in the defaults section and anything that's a placeholder. So that's what attributes mean. It's those two lists combined. And that's how you also do default values for a placeholder as well. You provide it there. And then enhance, add on additional attributes essentially, figure out the wrapper to use, the wrapping controller to use based on the MIME type, potentially other stuff there. We're actually doing upcasting there, so if you have a node, then you know, you do bracket node and type hint that in your controller, and then you'll get an actual node object just like you would have in Drupal 7. That also happens in the route enhancers. And then that comes back. And then a step after that is all the access control stuff. Now that we know the route, we can look at the route and say, all right, what's the permission on it? What's the entity access on it and so forth? All right. So next, this is a concept that is way scarier than it should be for most people, really. Dependency injection sounds like a trip to the doctor. It's not. A dependency is simply an object on which your object depends. That's it. It's some other piece of code that your code is going to use is a dependency. A service is specifically a global stateless object. Global stateless, what does that mean? It means stateless in the sense that once it's been set up and configured, you can call methods on it and its state won't change. You can call it multiple times and the exact same thing will happen. It does not persist information. It's not going to collect information as you call through the system and then return it later. You call it, you get something back, that's it. It's a pure function, essentially. And it's global in the sense that there is only one in the system at any given time. You do not implement that as a singleton. Singletons are evil. You instead use a dependency injection container to simulate that, and we'll get to that in a moment. So as an example, say we have this class status. Let's see if I can zoom this. Okay. And we have this show method on it, great. And it's going to pull data out of the database. Don't worry about exactly what we're pulling out and return it. And great. And if we want to unit test this, how do we do that? Well, we have to make sure the DB query function is defined. And we have to make sure that the database is set up and that the whatever table it's using is there. And that's a lot of work for a unit test. It's no longer a unit test. You're testing your database connection. Don't do that. So first step to fix that is simply, there we go. Pass in your database connection in the constructor. Save it, and then you can call the connection that way. And then you set it up, you create your database connection, pass that in, and then you can call that show method. Great. Now, when we want to do a unit test, I can pass in a fake database connection, a mock database connection, and I don't need a real database. I can test this this class in isolation. But how about the database class here? That still is hard-coded to something. So first thing we do is instead of database class, we pass in a database interface. 98% of the time, you want to type int on an interface, not a class. Type int on interfaces, not classes. That makes it a lot easier to swap out the dependencies without breaking things. Interfaces are your friend. But you know, that doesn't help enough. The database itself needs to also have its credentials passed in. And this is now getting really ugly, because just to call this show, we need to have 4 lines of code and set up a bunch of objects.
So how do we simplify this so that I don't have to do this myself every time? That's a dependency injection container. We have one in Drupal now. It is your friend. It sounds scary. It is your friend. It is simply the place where you wire stuff up so that you don't have to wire it up manually. That's all it is. It is the scariest possible name for a glorified array of objects. That's it. It's not nothing fancier than that. So once the container is wired up, you just call get status on it, and that gets back that status object. All of that's set up with the database and the credentials and all of the other dependencies. It's just taken care of elsewhere, and you don't think about it. That's the idea. You will pretty much never in code call this directly, except for a few specific places in like a controller. The main configuration for it is yet another YAML file. There will be, I think, 5 YAML files in a fully baked Drupal 8 module. The syntax for it is identical to the syntax in Symfony. It's a Symfony dependency injection container, so we're just using it wholesale, which has a ton of features in it. Your individual classes, however, do not know that they are using a dependency injection container. In almost all cases, if your code knows that there's a dependency injection container, you did it wrong. There are a few places where there's an exception to that, mostly factories for setting up objects, but for the most part, your code should not know that there's a container. It just gets stuff passed to it via its constructor. And the benefit here is primarily testability and swappability. Because this lets, you know, doing this properly lets us take any arbitrary piece of code and write a test for it using PHP unit instead of simple test, which means it runs in about 40 microseconds rather than 40 minutes. Who's tried to actually run web tests in simple test? How many cups of coffee were able to go get before it even finished one test? Yeah. When you do a true unit test, you can run through the entire core PHP unit set right now, just some 600 tests, in about, what is it, 5 seconds, was it?
Yeah, it's not long.
Yeah, something like that. So you want your code to be fast to test, you want it to be dependency injected. You don't, if you don't want your code to be easy to test, I don't want to use your module. So here's an example out of the core's YAML file. Let's see if I can make this bigger a little bit. So we've got this top level services. Why did you do that? Services key. And then we specify a service by name. And here's its class. And here's the arguments to its constructor. That's pretty much it. Each of these arguments begins with an at sign, which means this is the name of another service. So in this case, the router.dynamic service uses the Symfony CMF component routing dynamic router class. Its constructor has 3 parameters, to which we pass the router request context service, the router matcher service, and the URL generator. Don't worry for now about what those are. Okay? Those words mean nothing. Don't worry about that for the time being. The important thing here is this wiring, you can change. All of those, you know, 5 nested objects we saw before on the dynamic router and the flow chart and all that kind of stuff, that can all be rewired, and you can replace classes out of it at any time just by changing the injection container. What this means, if you want to run your routing system based on MongoDB instead of on MySQL, you replace 2 classes in the container and you're done. You want to run it off Redis, React, something like that, 2 classes, you're done. You want to rip out the entire routing system because you think you can do it better than Drupal can, you can do that and it doesn't count as hacking core. Yeah, someone said wow. So that's the benefit of this level of abstraction, is you're able to pull the pieces apart, unit test them, work on them independently, swap them out, reconfigure the whole system without having to edit code, just edit the configuration, or override it with a compiler pass or whatever. But you can hack core without hacking core, essentially. And that's just really cool. The kittens are fine.
That's the great thing. Dependency injection containers save kittens' lives. Questions? All right. Then I'm going to hand it back over to Robin, who is, oops, I'm sorry. this gets compiled down into this PHP code, essentially. It's not the exact code, but this is what you would have to do yourself if you were doing it yourself. You don't want to do it yourself, so the injection container does it for you. So now I'm going to hand it over to Robin to talk about configuration.
Thanks, Larry. It's been the Larry show the whole time. All right.
I think it's all you from here on in.
Probably will be. Okay, so configuration management, one of the initiatives in D8, and it's pretty exciting stuff. So we're going to cover what's happened with configuration management, how that works in D8, and then actually implement some settings for our Drupal Gachi module. So we'll see it in action. Oh, when I have the window there. Okay. So configuration is everything users and editors do not write, right? So think about it in terms of our usual suspects for configuration, like views and content types, view modes, image styles, permissions, things like that, and our module settings, right? So when an administrator comes in and configures our Drupal Gachi module, that's configuration as well. And when this system was implemented, basically all of that configuration moved into the YAML files that we've been mentioning again and again through this session, and it eliminated more than 50 tables from the Drupal database from core. Yeah, it's pretty exciting. And when what happens is when you're actually saving configuration, it is written directly to files and not to the database. Yes, there's a question. There is some caching in the database, but when you're actually clicking save, it's going directly into a file in your default slash files directory.
And if you're using an alternate cache, like Memcache or Redis or something like that, it goes to there instead for caching purposes. The canonical version is the YAML on disk. Nope. It's just on disk. It's not where it's. You don't have the weird double life that Features has.
I think I'm going to try and ask people to come up to the mic to ask questions, because I don't want to miss any of these. So if folks can start doing that would be great. And I know I've got one guy here.
Is it possible to store multiple configuration for a test system, for example? So I'm not overwriting then the settings from the productive system.
Oh, I see. So you wanted to have different configuration in your test environment. Yes.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, you could do that. So I don't think we're going to get into that level of detail here, but basically you can, the way the configuration is stored in these YAML files, it's written into a directory called the active directory, but you could there's another directory called staging, so that can be your test environment, so it can store different configuration for your staging environment. Some other important things, so we talked about YAML. If for those folks who haven't written YAML files aren't used to that, you can check it out on Wikipedia. They have a good description of how YAML works. And an important aspect to these files is that configuration is now translatable. So anybody who works with multilingual sites, this is a big plus. It's always been a problem. Okay. So, let's talk about forms and configuration. I have another question. You have to go to the mic, please. If you don't, I don't want you to export some settings. You want a local environment for your configuration settings? Right, so that's a matter of deciding how you're going to save those files, whether they're going into this Active Directory or staging, and that's set in the settings.php file. So you can specify basically the directory path about where your configuration is saved. So maybe.
So are you talking about like data your module is saving that you don't want to be deployed? So that might be a use case for the state system, which is a new feature of Drupal 8. We're going to, I think, kind of glaze over.
Yeah.
But check it out. There's some examples of it in the module if you look at the master branch. But the state system is a key value store that is not deployed. So that's where we're recording things like the last time cron was run, or the Drupal Gachi module records the happiness of the site in state. Because you don't want to deploy that, a different site's going to have a different level of happiness, but you do need to persist it. So that might be something to look into for what you're describing.
Okay, so let's get back to forms for a little bit. So when you're going to create your own form, you'll implement the form interface, and it comes with some methods, the build form, validate, and submit form methods, which should sound somewhat familiar. And the code is quite similar inside of those methods to how we create module forms in D7. So, but today we're actually going to focus on the administrative settings for our Drupal Gachi module, which works a little bit differently. So let's check that out. We think this is a typical use case for module developers that they need to have configuration settings for their module. So what we're going to do is we're going to create this administrative settings form. And in fact, let me show it to you. I'm going to quickly just check out some code here. Oh, I'm already on the lab controller complete. Great. So let's go back. So we can just see what this looks like quickly. I wonder when I last cleared the cache. Just to be safe. Oh, bad.
So one note on Drupal 8, it does compile PHP code to disk in a couple of places. I said the dependency injection container is one of them. The other is Twig. If that gets out of state or out of sync, the normal cache clear methods don't always work on that. The easy way to do that is, if you can't get to this page, site's default file's PHP. Just delete that directory. As of right now, you need to sudo to use it. There's a patch in the queue right now to not need to be sudo to do that. But that's how you clear that cache.
OK, thanks, Larry. That was nice filler.
Okay. I'm good at filling in for things.
So under configuration, we're going to have, in the system section, configure Drupal Gachi. And basically, this is where an administrator would choose the name of their Drupal Gachi. This is where your stuffed animal becomes very important. Whatever your stuffed animal's name is, that would be the name you would enter here. And you can decide how needy it is, how much attention it needs. So the more the slider is to the right here, the neediest increases. So I'm just going to continue with these values I have here. But this is the form that we're going to work on right now.
And note, this range slider here, this is an HTML5 element that should work in any Chrome version and in just the most recent Firefox. And I think IE does it now.
I think so.
If it doesn't, it naturally falls back to a text field, which is how HTML5 is designed. But it's just a native FAPI element now.
OK, so here's what you're going to need to get started. You need a route. You should already know how to do that. But now our route will be different. It's going to point to a form instead of content. We're going to create a menu item for it. And this is so that we can actually see that configure Drupal Gachi on the configuration page. So we still need hook menu so that we can actually place menu items in the navigation. We're going to create configuration schema, which basically defines the values of the Drupal Gachi name and the neediness value, right? So it's kind of describing what's the data type for Drupal Gachi name and, you know, what kind of label do we give it, that sort of thing. We're going to provide some default values for this configuration Like we saw when I went to that page, there were already some settings in there, so you can make sure default values are in the form. And we're going to make sure that our form class extends something called config form base. So this is specific to creating configuration type settings for your module. So if you haven't checked out lab-02-controller-complete, that's the branch you want to start from. It has some PHP stubs in there for us to get started. So you're going to start with your route first, and I'm just going to point out some of the unique features of the code from what we were doing before. Actually, Larry has his pointer. But what's important is under defaults, we have underscore form. In your previous routes that you were working on was underscore content. So that's one of our differences here. It points to our new class that's called settings form. So that's under... When we get into the directory, we'll see that's under lib/Drupal/Drupal-gachi, and then form will be a new directory that it should already be there in that branch with the file in it. So in our Drupal-gachi.module file, we're creating our typical menu item with hook menu. So that's all pretty much the same thing. The one difference is the route name is going to point to your new route in the routing.yaml file. Larry?
Also note, in about 2 to 3 weeks, I expect, this hook will get renamed to hook default menu items, because it won't be doing menus and routing anymore. It will just be default menu links right. And menu link items.
So that is a separation from how things worked mm-hmm. in D7. Yes, there's a question. It's, yeah.
Lab 02 stuff.
Lab-02-controller. So basically, that has the full controller code, and then our PHP stubs for working on the form. Another question.
Can you go to the next slide?
Yes.
Why now we have patterns instead of path?
Because we forgot to update this slide. It changed from pattern to path about a week and a half ago.
I tried to catch all of those. So it should be path, not pattern. Nice catch. Okay, so we went through our menu item. Configuration schema, so this is new. You should see in your DrupalGachi module, there's a directory called config, and within it is another one called schema. And so that file will be empty, and basically we're gonna add in this configuration structure for our module. So the way it works is we specify in DrupalGachi.settings, the type is mapping. And then you'll see the mapping section below. This applies directly to the two values we're going to store for our DrupalGachi module, right? So there's the name. It's of type string. We can give it a label. And needy is determining how much attention our DrupalGachi module needs. And then what you can do is, so here we were at /config/schema. I can provide default values at /config, and it's very simple. You put in the name of the field, or the machine name, really, of the value you want to store, so like needy, colon, and then the value. So this is pretty straightforward, and again, that should be in there, and you just need to kind of pass in the values that you'd like to provide. These are the default values for the settings. And then we get into lib, Drupal, DrupalGachi form, settingsform.php. So you need a construct that pulls in our config. We're gonna use a method called the create method, which basically brings back, it's static, and brings back our DrupalGachi settings. Do I have this right? In the container, is that correct?
Yeah, so
make sure I have that right.
The create static method you'll see in a couple of places. This is pretty much the only place you'll ever interact with the container, the dependency injection container directly. The idea is you don't want to have to register every form as a service or every controller as a service. That's nuts. So instead, if you have if you implement the right interface, which the base class here does, then let me just do this.
That's better.
Then this create method gets used as a factory for your class, and it gets passed the container. And so you can then return a new instance of static, which is PHP 5.3.4, this class. It's the same as self, but works correctly. And you pass to it a series of parameters. In this case, we're going to pass in just the config object that we want, Drupal Gotchi settings. And so this is just a pattern you're going to use over and over again. You grab the configuration factory, get the config object that is relevant for your module, pass it to the constructor, and then you can use that config object throughout your module, or throughout that class, excuse me.
Great, thanks, Larry. And then another method that I'm showing down here that you'll need is the getFormID, so this is your machine name for your form, and just returns a simple string. There are a couple more methods. We have our build form, which is just like the forms you used to build in D7. So get used to your form array and all of those lovely items. So I'm not going to go over this in too much detail because you can find this easily in D7. Just note that for this Drupal Gotchi module, that name is a string and that the needy field is a range field of type range.
Could go back one step?
Yeah.
One other thing that changed very recently since we were updating the slides.
Uh-oh. I know another slide update.
The T function you should not use anymore. That's now a service. Most of the common base classes like forms and controllers have a this arrow T method you can call instead, which does exactly the same thing. But you want to use that instead of calling the T function directly. Call the T function directly, you can't test this without doing, you know, the full minute and a half boot up of a web test. So this T is your friend. In procedural code, I think the T function still works, or you can access the service. The T function is now just a wrapper around the service, I think. The last vestiges of procedural code in Drupal still have some weirdness you have to do to get at services. Most things are going to be object-oriented, aside from hooks themselves.
Sorry, I was just checking. We still have the T function in our code as well, so you guys feel free to fix that.
Patch is welcome.
Okay. So we're building our form, and I just want to point out also the return is parent build form, and then you pass in the typical form and form state arguments. Okay, so, and then finally we have a submit form method, and basically all we need to do is make sure we add in our new fields and their values and to make sure they get saved. It's so straightforward, I love it. So it makes me really happy. And then we're at the end of our class for our form. So go ahead, get into settingsform.php. Remember that's in lib Drupal Gotchi form settingsform.php and start working on filling out those methods. And Larry and I will walk around. Just calling the parent first to, So here's, again, the list of things you're doing. You're creating your configuration schema and the default values. And then you're going into settingsform.php to manage that form.
someone wanted to see this code slide again, so I'm going to leave this up for a moment. You're right. This should be this config set. Good call. So
those who missed it, yet another bug on the slide. We have another bug report. The config set here should be this config set. Sorry about that.
The code is correct.
Okay. Sorry. It's just a bug in the slide. Okay, so we're winding down to the end here. So there's one question that a couple people had. We want to go over again, this create method. So we talked before about dependency injection and wiring up services with the YAML file. Who here wants to have to wire up a YAML file for every single controller in every single form? One person. You, sir, are weird. So instead, we have a pattern called factory method. It's a very common pattern in OO. When a controller or a form is wired up to a route, when the system is going through and instantiating that object, it will first check and say, all right, does it implement the container injection interface, which the config form base implements for us? If so, we know it has this create method. Call that create method and we'll let it take care of making that object, which means you need services, you can inject them yourself in that little factory. If it's not there, then it just calls new whatever that class is, new settings form, and the constructor gets no parameters. This lets us do injection, it lets us specify which services this object is gonna need without having to wire everything up in the container and end up with a container that has 5,000 items in it, because that would be ludicrous. The static keyword here, a couple people are asking for it. Who's used the self keyword before in OO? Static is exactly like self, but it's not broken. The self keyword, the way inheritance works with it, is totally broken in PHP. So static is exactly like self, but its inheritance works correctly, is the basic way to describe it. If we instead here did return new settings form, it would work perfectly. Static is just the generic for name of the class that I'm in. That's it. We're just going to skip ahead here and do a little bit of wrap up. Key takeaways that we want to make sure that you get out of this session. First, think in loosely coupled objects. We've all been used to the idea of make small modules that work together. That same concept, take another level down, and instead of having big functions that do five things, have loosely coupled objects that you assemble and let them do their thing. Let them do one task. That way you can reconfigure them, service container, forms, whatever, and change your code without hacking your code. That's the goal. Separate your business logic from your glue code. You'll notice the controllers we wrote were really, really small. We're used to having page callbacks that are like 50, 100, 300 lines long. Don't do that. If you have that kind of logic, break it out to a service, have your controller access that service, and then use it. That makes it easier to reuse that logic elsewhere, makes it easier to unit test that logic, and if that logic isn't coupled to something like forms, it means your logic is decoupled from Drupal itself, which means should someone break this API again, you're insulated from that. That's a good thing. So things like controllers should just be thin glue code. Your actual real logic should be separate from that. Display logic happens at the display layer. Twig is awesome. Twig does way more than PHP template ever did. Let Twig do what it's good at. Let your themers do what they're good at. They will thank you. At least my themers thank me. When I have a more complex example of that template at one point that I showed to people like Morton and other hardcore themers who hate module developers and all of the stuff we put them through, and they loved the level of control that it was giving them. So. Let the theme layer have that kind of power. Let your themers have that kind of power. You'll be a lot happier. They'll be a lot happier. And finally, the future is a rather different place. This is very different than Drupal 7. That's okay, because you can do an awful lot more. Your ability to reconfigure your system, your ability to rewrite your system, your ability to change code without changing code, essentially, is far higher than in any previous version of Drupal. Your ability to unit test and actually bother testing your module at all is way higher than in previous versions of Drupal. Embrace that, leverage it, build loosely coupled code, and you will have an easier time maintaining your modules going forward.
And this is supposed to be a Hitchhiker's Guide reference that I think we took out.
I don't know. I think that was Ken.
That was the don't panic slide that went missing. And we are going to be offering extended versions of this class through Palantir. Coming up in Chicago, one's in December, one in February. We're looking at a two-day training for that. So, you know, this was very compressed, as I'm sure everyone feels. Take that, stretch it out to a day, and then we have another day covering additional topics, more advanced topics. So look for more information on that on the Palantir blog, palantir.net. We are considering doing that outside of Chicago as well. Basically, when we find there's a market for it, we're willing to go after it. For the moment, we're just doing Chicago. But keep your eyes open if you want, you or your company wants a larger extended version. And thank you. Enjoy the rest of the conference.
Can you go to the next slide? Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Please do rate the session. We'd love the feedback. We'll be around for a little while yet if you still have questions.
That's right. It's coffee break time. So if people still want to work on code a little bit longer, Larry and I can hang around for a little bit longer.
And now that you all know Drupal 8, I expect you all at the sprints on Friday.
Oh, yeah. Sprint on Friday.